Over the course of the last year and a half, our homestead has grown and changed exponentially. From the spaces that we grow our garden in, to the amount of animals that we have, to now having a daughter, things have definitely been different. We started our homestead with a wide variety of animals, trying to figure out what it is that worked best for us and what we liked and what we didn't like and what gave us products that were useful for us to use in our everyday life and what might just be fun to have. And when I say we had everything, we had almost everything. And with adding all of these animals, we had put in all kinds of infrastructure, all kinds of fencing, and all kinds of things in order to take care of the animals' needs, necessities, and feed supplies. In December of 2022, we took a small trip down to Georgia to pick up 3 sheep. In preparation for having our daughter, we got rid of all of the goats that we had, we got rid of all of the chickens that we had at the time, and we had initially gotten these 3 sheep because we could always put them in the freezer if they weren't what we were looking for, but as fate would have it, we fell in love with these sheep. They gave us a new opportunity, an opportunity to teach people with herding demonstrations, an opportunity to work our dogs, and an opportunity to fall in love with an animal that really did fit our lifestyle. As time has gone by, many of the animals have come and gone. The sheep are the one thing so far that has stayed the test of time. And as our love has grown for these sheep, so has our flock.
I wanted to talk a little bit more about why we added sheep onto our homestead. We added a breed that made sense for us. I did a lot of research. I talked to a lot of breeders. I joined a couple breeder groups on Facebook just to get a better sense of what breed of sheep could do best on our homestead. So we have the Gulf Coast natives. They are a critically endangered breed of sheep. That means that less than 200 are registered annually in the United States and less than 1,000 registered annually over the whole world. And so it's a breed of sheep that not a lot of people have, that they don't focus a lot on the breeding aspect of that. But these sheep are a triple purpose, so meat, wool, and milk. And so we decided, you know what, let's go ahead and bring on a wool sheep because it'd be fun to be a little bit more self-sustainable. I think it would be really cool to someday take that raw wool and have pieces of clothing that we've made that were grown here on our own homestead. And we've got a lot of processing to go because It's a long process to take raw wool to a finished product. It's hours and hours of time cleaning, sorting, turning that into yarn, turning the yarn into a finished product. So it's going to be a process, but that's something that I would love to learn how to do. It's something that obviously like nobody in our family did, and so bringing back that skill and learning that skill is honestly my goal for 2024, is to learn the skill of taking the raw wool and turning it into a finished product. So we added those sheep for that purpose, but we also wanted a sustainable meat source. So on our homestead, the sustainable meat source is a source of meat where we don't have to continually purchase breeding stock, or we don't have to continually purchasing stock. So when we raise a batch of Cornish cross meat birds, those are not sustainable because we have to go and purchase those day old chicks from a hatchery. That's not something that is contained from here on our homestead. And so adding a ewe and a ram, that allows us to have meat in the future. So that's why we added sheep. Well, this past year, around summertime, I started looking into breeders that had females available, and I really wanted to just bring on a bred female, so a pregnant female, but that was really hard to find. I had found one breeder in Tennessee that had that as an option, but it ended up that the female actually needed to be treated for a really bad case of worms, and so they offered us to get out of purchasing her because they knew that it was important to us to not have an animal that had been treated or needed to be treated for that. So fast forward, we went back to the breeder that we got our initial sheep from. She's down in Central Georgia. And although it's a drive, we said, hey, this is what we're looking for. These are our plans. What are your thoughts on this? And she said that she would be willing to give us one of her females after breeding season was over, as well as her ram and another wether. So we said, okay, that sounds good. So we placed our deposit back in August, and about a month ago, we went and picked those sheep up. We took 8 dogs with us and our baby, who is just over a year old now, so she's almost 14 months by the time this video comes out. And it was quite the road trip. We made a trip out of it, and we stopped to visit some friends that we hadn't seen for 2 years. For us, we wanted a sustainable source of meat. And when we talked about bringing on 3 more so that we would have a total of 6 sheep, there has been one specific sheep that keeps, I guess, just being ornery. And when I first started researching sheep, Greg Judy is very well known for raising sheep in the homesteading community. And a lot of people go to his books and his resources to learn more about raising sheep on pasture and rotating them and whatnot. And one thing I remember clearly Greg Judy saying is, if you have a sheep that begins jumping the fence, you need to eat it, because you do not want the other sheep to learn the bad behavior from that sheep. And so we have this one sheep that when I would use the dogs to work with when we would rotate, he always broke off from the flock. The only sheep that has ever gone through the hot wire fences that we have around our perimeter was this one sheep. And I had to send Rogue to go out and get this sheep and bring it back in through the fence. And so ahead of time in our minds, we said, okay, once we get more sheep, that sheep is going to the processor. And Although we have butchered a sheep before, we talked about sending this sheep to a USDA licensed processor so that we could potentially sell half of the meat. Now, the reason why we wanted to sell half of the meat was honestly to see if there was a market locally for that. Give somebody the opportunity to purchase grass-fed, grass-finished lamb in our area, because there's not a lot of places to do that here where we are. And then also to help cover the cost of processing, because that's something that we've always looked at when adding livestock and when making different decisions about the garden or the livestock or whatnot, is how can we have it pay for itself? And so honestly, selling half of that meat covered the cost of taking that animal to the butcher versus us, you know, paying that right out and not only being in for the cost of the animal, but then being in for the cost of having that animal butchered. So we went ahead and we took this sheep to the butcher this past week. And I shared on our Instagram stories, all morning that morning I had told myself, it's gonna be all right. This was his purpose. We knew that this could potentially be the end result for him. And I knew it would be okay. But we got him unloaded. And I honestly felt a huge blanket of guilt. And I feel like a lot of people have the opposite feeling of that, you know, and a lot of people in the homesteading world that we know of anyways, they would prefer sending their animals to a processor versus doing it themselves. And there's no shame in that. There's no shame in that whatsoever. Everybody's different. And I felt shame because any animal we brought onto our homestead would leave by our hand. Meaning that we were willing, if we said, yes, we're going to bring an animal onto our homestead, we're going to care for that animal, that meant that we were going to butcher that animal. We were going to be there present for its one bad day. And I felt a lot of shame taking this animal to somebody else to butcher. And I really struggled with that. And it's, I don't know if it's because, like, I put so much effort into, you know, raising that animal while it was here on the homestead caring for it. But I felt a lot of guilt and shame over that because I wasn't doing it myself. And I feel like in today's society, we feel so much shame and guilt for things that we're not doing, rather than feeling pride in what we are doing. Like, rather than feeling guilty that I wasn't butchering that animal, like, I should have been proud that I raised this animal on our homestead. I gave it the best life possible, and then it was going to go on to nourish not only our family but somebody else's family. But instead I felt this shame and guilt because I wasn't pulling the trigger myself. And I wasn't holding the blade myself. And I really, truly struggled with that. We dropped him off and they put him in like the sorting pen. And the gentleman that was there, you know, was super nice. He said that they make sure all of the animals are treated with care and respect. And like, we talked about that. And I asked Josh to pray over the animal because I was bawling. I was bawling and I could not bring myself to pray over the animal. And that's something that we do every time we go to butcher, is we pray over the animals that we have raised here and we thank them for the nourishment that they are going to go on to give our bodies. And I had Josh pray over the sheep, and he prayed over that sheep go on to nourish not only our bodies, but the bodies of that family that was going to also be getting the meat from us. And I was really, really saddened about the whole event. And that whole day, I just wanted to sit in that sadness. And I shared on our social media. I said, you know, our food system is so broken. So broken that people don't feel anything when they buy meat at the grocery store. And I try to remind myself how blessed we are to be in the position where I feel so much about this sheep. This silly sheep that just acted out, that would go and do whatever he wanted and just act like a fool, that would frustrate me and frustrate my dogs. But honestly, like, he helped make my dogs better because of how frustrating he was. And I feel so much about this sheep. And if you're new to homesteading or you're wanting to get into homesteading, the feelings are so real. I can't tell you how many animals I've cried over, and some because we've butchered them, and some because they've just died, and some because I've been so happy about certain experiences. You know, where we've had babies born on the homestead. Like, I've had tears of joy. And but if you're getting into this, I encourage you to feel all the feels. It's tough, but man, it's so rewarding. We had the family come and pick up the meat from this lamb yesterday, and it was so good to be able to help provide for this family. But I love having these sheep on our homestead, and I love how they've made me feel and how they've made us feel, and the impact that these sheep make on our community, not only because of the meat that we're able to share, but also all of the people that they've helped educate at the events that we've taken them to. And we have a few events this year that I'm really excited to take our dogs to. There's another event where I'm just going to go and speak at about working dogs and how to pick the perfect working dog. And so these sheep have not only been a part of our homestead, but I know that they've been a part of a lot more people's lives than what we even realize. So I'm thankful, and I'm excited to share this story with you guys. I had a lot of feelings about it. And that's okay. And I'm telling myself that it's okay to have a lot of feelings. As Scout, our daughter, has gotten a little older, being 14 months now, we've learned to tell her it's okay to have a lot of feelings. Because she has a lot of feelings, but she doesn't know how to control those feelings sometimes. And so we tell her it's okay. It's okay to have a lot of feelings. It's normal. As you get older, you learn how to control them and handle them a little bit more. And sometimes even as adults, we don't know how to handle our feelings.
Thank you.
Well, that's why you gotta make yours look better.
Okay, so I think it's safe to say I didn't even get the camera over here before it's gone.
It's so good.
Yeah,
so good.
It's good.
Yep.
You got a little piece left right there.
Well,
Saving that for later.
It's a little fatty piece.
Oh, a little fatty piece. Okay.
Yeah, it's your kind of piece.
But in the grand scheme of things, after all the heartbreak and everything, is it totally worth it? Okay. We're going to do it again?
Yeah.
Okay.
And we're going to get more eventually.
Coming full circle?
Yep.
Perfect.